New Zealand is a cluster of islands in the South Pacific with a large dairy industry. But when New Zealand was discovered by Europeans, they found a land filled with bush and birds. There were no large native land mammals, and the indigenous people, the Māori, didn't have any domesticated animals with them other than dogs. So how did the dairy animals first make it to New Zealand? Where did they come from? And was their milk used to make cheese? Hey there, cheese historians! I'm Julia, and this is Cheese History, a channel all about the origins, history, and impact of cheese. I'm a New Zealander, so I figured that it was about time I did something on the cheese history of my own country. I was originally only going to do one video on this, but I found much more to talk about than I expected, so there will be other videos on cheese history coming soon. Watch out for those. I'm aware that there is a good chance that you, my dear viewer, may not know much about New Zealand's history. So before we get into the cheese history of New Zealand, let's do a brief tour of New Zealand's early history, so that the early cheese history makes more sense. I'm then going to look at when dairy animals first arrived in New Zealand, and how and when people started making cheese, right up to about the time when dairy farms start to appear. So let's get into a brief summary of New Zealand's early history. What follows is an incredibly simplified version of New Zealand's history. I have had to leave out much of the detail and nuance because otherwise this would be a video on New Zealand history rather than New Zealand cheese history. Even though we have a relatively short history, at most 800 years, and a recorded history of around 200 years, there is still far more to it than can be summarised in a few minutes. Anyway, here we go! New Zealand is a remote cluster of islands in the South Pacific. It was first settled by the ancestors of the Māori people who sailed here from somewhere in the Pacific around 1300. Due to its long geographic isolation, New Zealand has no native land mammals, except for two types of bats. So during the first 600 years or so of human habitation, there were no animals that could produce milk to make cheese. The first Europeans to discover New Zealand were Dutch explorer Abel Tasman and his crew in 1642. There was a clash between Tasman's crew and the local Māori, resulting in the death of four of the Europeans. So Europeans didn't really return until the voyages of British explorer James Cook in 1769. From that point, whalers and sealers often stopped to resupply, particularly in the north of New Zealand. In the early 1800s, Christian missionaries arrived, as did some settlers to add to the whalers and sealers that were already using New Zealand as a resupply point, and trading with the local Māori. As time went on, the number of European settlers slowly increased. In 1840, a treaty was signed between the British Crown and the Māori tribes at Waitangi, in the very north of the North Island of New Zealand. The treaty gave the Crown sovereignty over New Zealand and the sole right to buy land. New Zealand became part of the British Empire and all Māori became British subjects, gaining the protection of the Empire. However, the increasing number of settlers and a series of conflicts with the Māori over several decades led to most Māori land being sold, illegally occupied, or confiscated by the end of the 19th century. The repercussions of these events are still being felt today. Most of the settlers who arrived after the Treaty of Waitangi came from the United Kingdom, and much of the settled land was cleared for farms, including dairy farms. So where did those first dairy animals come from, and when did they first arrive? When I set out to look into the history of cheese in New Zealand, I came across the story of the first cows to arrive in New Zealand. They were shipped over from the British colony in New South Wales, Australia. There were one bull and two cows of a breed known as English Shorthorns, and they were a gift to Reverend Samuel Marsden from Lachlan Macquarie, the governor of New South Wales. Shorthorns were a very versatile breed of cattle, as they could be used for meat, milk, and as beasts of burden. Thus, they were an excellent choice for the new mission station that Marsden planned to establish in New Zealand on behalf of the Church Missionary Society, a group in the United Kingdom who supported missionaries spreading the Christian message throughout the world. Samuel Marsden was an Anglican minister and chaplain to the New South Wales colony, but he took it upon himself to organise and support the spread of the Christian message to the indigenous people of New Zealand, the Māori. The first cows were shipped across the Tasman aboard a ship he bought, the Active, along with other animals and supplies needed to set up a Christian mission station in the north of New Zealand, having been invited to do so by a chief from the local Ngāpuhi tribe named Ruatara. They arrived on the 22nd of December 1814 in Rangihua Bay. While unloading the ship, one of the cows got loose and charged a curious group of local Māori who had gathered to watch the spectacle of the unloading of these strange creatures from the ship. They were understandably terrified of having such a large animal rush straight at them. This was the first time these Māori had seen such animals, but it was not the first time any Māori had seen cows. By this point, several Māori, including some chiefs, had travelled to Australia and even further afield, usually on whaling ships. There were already herds of cattle in Australia, so it is likely that some Māori encountered them on their travels. There were probably more than just two cows and one bull on the active too. It seems that Governor Macquarie was quite fond of making presents of cattle, because he gifted one cow each to three Māori chiefs who departed Sydney for New Zealand on the 19th of October 1814 on board the active. One of these chiefs was Ruatara, the chief who had invited Marsden in the first place. Ruatara died early the following year in March 1815. Before he died, he made sure that his aunt would inherit his cow, who now also had a calf. So it looks like there were at least five cows and one bull on the active as it crossed the Tasman Sea between Australia and New Zealand. Fences were also in short supply in the early years of European settlement, so many of the cows wandered about in the bush, wild rather than domesticated. The cow that charged the curious Māori shortly after it arrived may have been the first of these, as I couldn't find any mention of it being captured. Regardless, wild cattle would have been much more challenging to milk. Cows aren't the only animal whose milk can be used to make cheese. Goats and sheep are also pretty common sources of milk. Well, apparently there were also goats and sheep on board the active, according to the account of John Nicholas, a settler in Australia who travelled to New Zealand with Marsden. The sheep were likely mainly kept for wool and meat, and could well have been the ancestors of some of the sheep on the enormous sheep farms that would come to dominate much of New Zealand in the mid-19th century. Goats were used as milking animals too, when cows were in short supply. Mrs. Maxton, who arrived in 1842, noted that cows were unknown, but there were plenty of goats. We used their milk for some time, and the same animal serves us for meat. So, from 1814, there were three different types of animal in New Zealand that could have been used for cheesemaking. Anyway, back to the first settlers. Marsden negotiated the purchase of 80 hectares of land to build a mission station before heading back to Australia. He left the first group of settlers to build the mission station and start spreading the message of Christianity among the Māori, at first by teaching them the skills of European civilization, and later by teaching them about Christianity and translating the Bible into the Māori language. As years passed, Marsden sent many more supplies, including more cows across the Tasman to support this fledgling colony. More mission stations were established around the far north over the coming years, and each of them kept at least a couple of dairy cows to supply them with milk. Through breeding and further imports, the Northland herd had increased to 25 by 1821. 8 years later, it had expanded to 95 beasts. Despite this growth in numbers, large-scale farming wasn't yet a viable option, as the mission stations were restricted by the availability of good grazing. The early herds grubbed their food from the scrub and ferns that surrounded the mission stations, a far cry from the green pastures of Mother England. The reason for the lack of pasture for cows is that New Zealand was predominantly covered by thick bush. Before Māori arrived, New Zealand was almost all forest, except for a few areas in the South Island, and particularly the many snow-covered mountains. Māori had cleared some land, mainly by burning, for their settlements and farming, but nowhere near as much as would be cleared by later European settlers. Grass seed also had to be imported, so until decent pasture for cattle could be created, the earliest cows had to eat shrubs and ferns, and some ended up dying from eating toxic plants. As time passed, and particularly after the signing of the Treaty of Waitangi in 1840, and the number of arriving settlers greatly increased, more and more land was cleared for houses and farms, so raising herds of cattle for meat and milk became more viable. In the years and decades that followed the arrival of the first shorthorn cows, other breeds of cattle were also introduced, including Ayrshires in 1843, purebred Jerseys in 1882, Frisians in 1884, and Holsteins in 1904. These breeds were less versatile than the shorthorns, being bred for both the quality and quantity of their milk. Some arrived as the ship's milk cow during the long voyage halfway around the world from Britain, while others were shipped out with the express purpose of creating dairy herds. So from the very early days of European settlement, there were many options for making cheese, dependent, of course, on the missionaries' abilities to keep their animals alive and on whether or not any of them knew how to make cheese. So did any of them know how to make cheese? The cows first brought to New Zealand from Australia were primarily to provide milk and meat for the early settlers. But did they make any of that milk into butter and cheese? I couldn't find much evidence of cheese making among the earliest settlers. They were building settlements, figuring out how to make lives for themselves in the New Zealand landscape and climate, learning how best to get along with their Māori neighbours, and particularly in the first decade or so, fighting among themselves. As many of the cows ended up roaming wild, collecting milk could prove difficult, let alone the effort to make that milk into butter or cheese. Butter is mentioned alongside milk, beef, and labour as the benefits of having cattle for the earliest missionary settlers in a report about the New Zealand mission station from a meeting of the Church Missionary Society in 1819. That cheese is not mentioned suggests that in the early days of the mission, the more immediate products like milk and butter were preferred, probably because they require less work and skill than cheese. However, I did come across a letter from Reverend Samuel Marston to Reverend J. Pratt, dated the 15th of January, 1823. The time has now come when I should state to you my object in sending cattle to New Zealand. My wish was that the missionaries in time should be supplied with milk, butter, cheese, and animal food, which would in great measure render them independent of the natives for support. Their number must now be 50 or upwards, and many of them females of the best breed. Just to be clear, in that last comment, he is talking about the cattle, not the settlers. So by this point, Marsden sees cheese as one of the benefits of having cattle in New Zealand as part of the mission station. Whether this means that cheese is being produced at this time is hard to say, but it's not impossible. As time passed and more settlers arrived, the chances of some of them knowing how to make cheese increased. By the 1840s, cheese was being made. In the 1845-46 season, Two Banks Peninsula farmers, John Gebby and his brother, made nearly 1,000 kilograms of cheese for shipment not only to Wellington, but also as far afield as New South Wales. So I guess the best I can say is that sometime between 1814 and 1840, someone somewhere in New Zealand started making cheese. Of course, locally made cheese wasn't the only option. Some cheese was imported from Britain and Australia, but this reached a peak in 1868 when 92 tons arrived. I dare say the long voyage halfway around the world, if it was coming from Britain, didn't help to make imported cheese affordable. Some tried to get around this by simply stealing cheese, but that didn't always end well. James Burnett, 28, was charged with stealing one tin of cheese, weighing 9.5 pounds, and one keg of butter, the property of James Gary at North Tyree on the 21st of October 1865. Burnett was found guilty of stealing butter and cheese at the Upper Tyree, was sentenced to 12 months imprisonment with hard labour. The lesson learned here is, don't steal other people's tins of cheese and kegs of butter. I'm still trying to imagine what a tin of cheese looks like, especially one weighing 9.5 pounds. That's 4.3 kilos. I have questions about how this worked, and I may have to look into this one day. So importing cheese could be expensive, and stealing it clearly wasn't much of a long-term plan either, unless you fancy 12 months in prison doing hard labour. Instead, settlers on small farms began making and selling cheese. In the mid to late 19th century, more immigrants arrived from all over the world, seeking a new and better start for themselves. They worked hard to be able to buy small parcels of land, often far from the main settlements, and set about clearing that land of the dense bush. They then had to produce whatever they could in order to make some sort of living. One of the things they could produce with a few cows was butter and cheese. This they could sell to local stores, who in turn sold them locally or began to ship them to Australia. As this was before refrigeration, the trip to Australia could separate the good quality cheese and butter from the poor quality. So the pressure was on the small farmers to improve the quality of their cheese and butter, otherwise it wasn't going to sell. Most of these small family farms weren't necessarily run by people with experience making cheese. They were people trying to make a living on farms some distance from the nearest town, and were doing whatever they could to make a living. Many came over to New Zealand as farm labourers with their families. the cheesemakers were mainly women, some of whom may have worked as dairy maids, but others may have been making simple cheeses just to feed their families. So the process of producing high-quality cheese would have been a slow one for some. In 1853, 4% of exports from New Zealand were butter and cheese, a total of £12,000. Most of the cheese exported was cheddar, because it could withstand the rigours of the 3-week voyage to Australia. That's not a bad start, considering there were only 5 cows and a bull brought over from Australia 40 years before. By 2019, New Zealand is home to 10 million cows, 6.2 million of which are part of the extensive dairy industry. Of course, they have a long way to go still to catch up with the most numerous livestock animal, the sheep, of which there are over 26 million in New Zealand in 2019. Just for reference, the human population of New Zealand is around 5 million, so we are considerably outnumbered by both cows and sheep. You may be wondering what happened to the sheep and goats, and why I have spent so long talking about cows in this video. Well, sheep have been farmed extensively here since very early in our history, and as I mentioned, we still have around 26 million sheep. The vast majority aren't kept for milk though, but rather for wool, which was one of the main early exports after 1814, with sheep farms being much more common than dairy farms. As far as I can tell, goats have never really been much of a domestic herding animal in New Zealand. Clearly they were used in the early years, but really only when cows weren't around. Today there are a few cheesemakers that make goat's milk cheeses, and even fewer who make sheep's milk cheeses in New Zealand. They are far and away dwarfed by the dairy farms that produce the cow's milk to make most of the cheese consumed in this country. New Zealand's cheese history started simply with 6 cows, some sheep and goats arriving from Australia with the first Christian missionaries. From there it developed slowly, with milk from the early cows that didn't go wild being used to make butter and perhaps cheese to feed the families of the settler farmers. Eventually, over the many decades, small dairy farms began to develop, making cheese and butter for local and Australian markets. This is not all there is to know about New Zealand's cheese history though, so if you're interested in knowing about the rise of the cheese making industry in New Zealand, stay tuned as I'm going to make a separate episode on that. If you're interested in anything cheese history related, please subscribe and do whatever else you need to do to make sure you don't miss out on any future episodes. Let me know in the comments if there are any countries or cheeses that you're particularly interested in knowing the cheese history of. And I'll see you next time!